Now, the second most high yield topic is supracondylar fracture of the humerus. You know that the humerus in the lower end is having a medial epicondyle and a lateral epicondyle. Okay, so any fall on the outstretched hand is the classical predisposing mechanism for supracondylar fracture. Whenever the child falls, he falls in hyperextension, and that hyperextension. Whenever you fall on outstretched hand, falling on hyperextension of the elbow is the mechanism where the fracture will occur above the level of the condyles in the humerus is what you need to basically remember. And where is the fracture line? Typically the fracture line will extend transversely in the distal metaphysis, not epiphysis, metaphysis of the humerus above the level of the condyles, hence called as supracondylar fracture. Now let us see the fracture line. See, this is the humerus, this is the radio and ulna, and here above the level of the condyles you are having the fracture line in the metaphysis is the description of supracondylar fracture. Now this is a child with a supracondylar fracture above the level of the condyles with the surrounding soft tissue showing the hemorrhage. Now what are the various types of supracondylar fracture? You have a extension type, you have a flexion type, two types. Extension type is commoner. Why you call it as extension type? It is called extension type because if you take in relation to whenever there is a fracture, there is one proximal segment and distal segment. The distal segment is tilted backwards compared to that of the proximal segment. The humerus is fractured, proximal segment is there, distal segment is there. Distal segment is tilted backwards in relation to proximal segment, hence called extended variety. So extension type is more common. If it is distal segment tilted forward compared to that of the proximal, you call it as flexion type, which is less common. So this is how you have the anterior humeral line, which is the important landmark based on which you classify. You call this as a Gotland. They are called Gotland type 1, 2, 3. Gotland type 1, still they have, there is not much of displacement. There is a fracture but no displacement. Here there is a fracture with the displacement. And in this is called type 3. This is, there is a total displacement. The distal fragment has gone behind the proximal segment. What type is, you call it as extension type or flexion type? When the distal fragment became behind, then that became extended type basically. Now what are the important clinical signs in case of supracondylar fracture? Because that distal fragment has moved behind, what will it do to, it lead to an unusual prominence at the point of the elbow, olecranon level may. And since the fracture is above the condyles, the relation between olecranon and the two condyles called triangular relationship is still maintained. See, this is olecranon, these are the two condyles, fracture is above this level. There's a reason still the relation, three bony point relation is not altered. This is one favorite MCQ for examiner. In which type of fracture? Is it lateral condylar, medial condylar, olecranon or supracondylar? Where is the three bony point relation is not altered? Supracondylar, it is not altered. There is an interruption of the blood flow because of the supracondylar fracture, and brachial artery become injured because it is passing. And this breakdown will lead to the injury to the brachial artery. The radial pulse, ulnar pulse, they may typically become absent. And a very important nerve that become injured is the median nerve. Median nerve will be giving to anterointraosseous branch. That is the one which will be commonly injured. Radial nerve also can be injured but less commonly. Radial nerve gives rise to posterior intraosseous branch. Anterointraosseous nerve comes from median nerve. So median nerve, more commonly anterotensioous branch of the median nerve is the one which is involved in supracondylar fracture, one of the favorite MCQs of the examiner. What do you see whenever you do the radiograph? In a AP view, you can be able to see that the fracture has led to proximal shift, medial or lateral shift, a medial tilt, and the rotation of the distal fragment. All these can be appreciated. Similarly, lateral view, from laterally if you can see, the proximal shift, how is the distal fragment? Is it moved proximally or distally? Did it move anteriorly or posteriorly? All those things can be basically appreciated about the distal fragment in case of lateral view. It is the movement of the distal fragment that classifies the tumor into flexion type and extension type, right? Backward movement will lead to extension type of the distal fragment, forward movement will lead to, anterior movement will lead to flexion type of supracondylar fracture. Now let us see, what do you like to call distal fragment, more behind or aage? Piche gaye, isliye extension type. So how do you treat? With an undisplaced fracture, can it be undisplaced? We have seen Gotland type 1, it is not a displaced. Then you can do immobilization with an above-elbow plaster slab is what you need to do, and you keep the elbow in a 90 degree flexion. That is what you need to fundamentally remember. Whenever there is a displaced fracture, then how do you want to manage? You have to admit the child to the hospital, and there are complications which can occur because of this displaced fracture. It can compress brachial artery, it can compress anterointraosseous nerve, anything can happen. So you have to examine for them. So this is a typical immobilization method. From where to where you will apply the cast, 90 degree you will flex it and apply the cast all the way as high as possible into the towards the shoulder and as far as possible up to metacarpal joints. Until there you put the cast, hence called above elbow plaster slab is what you have to basically place it. Then what are the various methods to treat if it is a displaced fracture? One way is you do closed reduction and you do percutaneous K-wire fixation. That's what you can be able to do. Then the important thing about is to do closed reduction is how are the muscular attachments to the bone is the important deciding factor. So supracondylar fracture is a fracture which is easily amenable for a closed reduction. So most of the displaced fractures can easily be reduced with closed reduction, but they can slip after reduction. That's the reason you need to fix them by using the K wires which are being passed percutaneously. That is what you have to basically do. Let us see. I'll show you the radiograph after doing the closed reduction with K wire fixation. Okay, then you can do the traction with the elbow in 30 to 40 degrees flexion. And this will correct the proximal displacement. Suppose if the distal fragment after the fracture has proximally moved, you have to drag it back, no? For that you need to apply traction, no? How will you apply traction? You will do 30 to 40 degree flexion mein traction lagate. And that will help to bring back the proximally displaced one. One is anteroposterior displacement, other is proximal displacement. There can be a medial lateral displacements also of the distal fragment. So for the medial lateral displacements and proximal displacements, apply the traction and drag it back. That's what you need to basically remember. And by doing that, you can maintain the carrying angle. It's very important, you know. That's the point. Now, this is the fracture, supracondylar fracture. Keeping the elbow at how much degrees? 30 to 40 degrees of flexion. You are trying to apply the traction. By doing that, what are you doing? You are pulling a proximally displaced fragment into normal location. Then what will you do after doing the traction? You will apply pressure on the olecranon. You have pulled it back, the proximally displaced segment. Then you apply the pressure on the olecranon and you will basically maintain the traction with and bring the elbow into 90 degree flexion. And whenever you are doing this maneuver, applying traction and then bringing it to 90 degrees, you should be careful to see whether the radial artery got traffic jammed between the fracture pieces by feeling the radial pulse. And once you have brought the two bones into alignment, proximal distal, then you need to get the elbow back into extended position. You need to maintain flexion. Suppose while doing flexion, traction in flexion, suppose if the radial artery pulsation is gone, what you need to do, once more you extend it so that that kinking of the radial artery is being avoided. That's what you need to do. So this shows the correction of side to side tilt and the rotation of the distal segment that is basically corrected, and you need to flex the elbow ultimately, and then you need to apply the above elbow plaster cast. That is how the reduction is basically done. Okay, doctor. And after doing the reduction and applying the plaster cast, you need to take an x-ray after 48 hours. And also, you need to take one more x-ray after 1 week so that you can detect any, by chance, redisplacement happened, is what you can be able to look. In case there is no redisplacement, then the plaster can be retained and it can be removed after 3 weeks is considered to be the management. That is all the story of what closure deduction and applying the plaster cast. Then you can also cut and do open deduction under operative field and do K-wire fixation. That is another possibility. When is this indicated? Obviously, when closed reduction fails, you want to do, or chances of failing of closed reduction are there, you will do open reduction and K-wire fixation. Okay, doc. So, if it is not possible to get a good position by closed reduction, or you have done closed reduction, applied above elbow plaster, but later on it got redisplaced. And similarly, if the fracture happened and already there is a lot of injury, that it is an open fracture. Closure fracture is all tissues intact and inside fracture is there. Open fracture, if it is already there, you can do open reduction. And suppose if the brachial artery is geopardized, vascular injury is there, you need to re-explore the brachial artery. Otherwise, the entire limb suffers ischemia. For that, you need to do anyway operative opening, hence open reduction. That's what you need to basically do. So, earlier days, they used to do continuous traction, just like gallus traction. Nowadays, it is no more, that barbaric thing is not done. Right? Continuous traction. Continuous traction you need to maintain in a place where there is a great chance of redisplacement. But this is not like that. Supraclavicular fracture is a very benign fracture. If you apply traction and put into a 90 degree elbow flexion and then apply above elbow plaster, it will nicely realign. So, no need of continuous traction is what need to be remembered. Now, this is a typical appearance. This is a fracture. How is the distal fragment? Displaced posteriorly. Hence, it is an extension type. And because of that, you have reduced it back and applied the K-wire fixation. That's what you have done after a reduction. Then after 8 months of follow-up, the patient has completely improved, and improvement of any elbow, around elbow fracture, any fracture around elbow, improvement means what improvement? Pronation, supination must happen freely, right? So then the child is able to do nicely. So it is a successful management. Then similarly, in a 5-year-old child, this is a pre-operative film of a type 3 open fracture. And in this case also, the K-wires got applied and the child is able to carry on the activities with good functionality. Now, what are the complications of supracondylar fracture? There can be an immediate injury to the brachial artery which can occur. Who injures brachial artery? Is it the distal fragment which will poke into the radial artery? The brachial artery or the proximal? It is a proximal segment which has a sharp edge which will do that. So, you need to be careful. Then, If at all brachial artery got injured, then what will happen? There's a lot of ischemia to the flexor muscles, and Volkmann's ischemic contracture can develop in those people, and the vascular compromise can lead to development of a gangrene. Now you can see a baby who has suffered supracondylar fracture. Brachial artery got injured, and later on there is a development of Volkmann's ischemic contracture due to the contracture of the flexor muscles of the forearm. Then injury to the nerves can happen. Median nerve, most commonly the anterior interosseous branch of the median nerve, is most commonly injured. Radial nerve can be injured, but most of the times the injury is a neuropraxia. Nerve injuries are classified into neuropraxis, neurotmesis, a complete breakdown of the nerve. Anything can be. So it's only a neuropraxic injury. Then what are other complications? There can be Volkmann's ischemia, where the flexor compartment can suffer due to the brachial artery injury, and so one important thing about the brachial artery is, there is a branch of brachial artery called anterior interosseous artery. It is an end artery. It is an end artery. That's the reason any brachial vascular compromise will lead to diminished blood flow through that. It being an end artery will make flexor muscles suffer from ischemia. That's the reason Volkmann's ischemic contracture will develop. This is a baby whose child, child whose hand is showing the typical Volkmann's ischemic contracture. Okay. Now, this is a splint which you can apply in order to manage the contracture, Volkmann's ischemic contracture. Then another very frequently asked MCQ is, in the flexor compartment, what are the most common muscles which are involved in the Volkmann's ischemic contracture? What is your answer? Flexor pollicis longus, pollex means thumb, and the medial half of the flexor digitorum profundus. They are the ones which are most affected muscles in the Volkmann's ischemic contracture, is what you have to be 100% sure. So what will happen to the child? Child will complain severe pain in the forearm when Volkmann's ischemic contracture is there. He can't be able to move his fingers fully, and in fact the fracture pain will be less, ischemic pain will be more. That's a more important issue. And another important clinical feature is called stretch pain in case of Volkmann's ischemic contracture. If you ask the child to extend his fingers passively, if you happen to extend his fingers passively, then the pain will become very severe in his flexor compartment. Fundamentally, what is the problem in Volkmann's ischemic contracture? All the flexor group of muscles got fibrosed. So the finger gone into flexion. If you try to passively extend it, you are trying to stretch something which is fibrosed, and that leads to development of severe pain. Then the fingers will show swelling and numbness, but it is a late feature in Volkmann's ischemic contracture. And locally also tenderness is there in the forearm muscles. So how do you treat? If Volkmann's ischemic contracture is there post supracondylar fracture, it's an emergency. And you should remove all the bandages, anything which is causing constriction immediately. You need to elevate the forearm and ask the child to move his fingers. And if there is no improvement within 2 hours, then you need to do fasciotomy in order to relieve the pressure. That's what you need to basically do. That's all the story of Volkmann's ischemic contracture. No other complications. Malunion is a late complication. In fact, if I say commonest complication of all complications in supracondylar fracture, what is your answer? Not Volkmann's ischemic contracture, but malunion is what you need to remember. Because of the malunion between the distal fragment and proximal fragment, the child will end up in a cubitus varus deformity. Valgus is out, varus is in. So varus deformity is what will basically develop. Why varus deformity occur? Because the distal fragment is tilted medially and it is internally rotated. Distal fragment. Because of that, whenever the fusion occur, it lead to outward curvature. Valgus means what? Inward curvature. Like as in the female's elbow. But here, outward curvature will develop because the distal fragment has moved medially and tilted internally. That's the reason cubitus varus deformity will be developing. Then malunion can occur. What is the underlying cause? Either your reduction is not sufficient or the displacement is displacement happened while inside the plaster, and at the time of healing wrong sticking has happened. So that's what you will basically conclude. So this is an example of what? Varus. Cubitus varus deformity is what has developed outward curvature after the supracondylar fracture. This once more, a varus outward deformity, because the proximal fragment, distal fragment, what happened to that? Internally rotated and medially tilted. And because of that, varus has basically developed. Then if you put this hand, if you stretch a varus hand, it looks like a gun. And it's called gun stock deformity is the name given for this cubitus varus deformity which has developed. Then sometimes what can happen, there can be a sticking of the two fragments with a distal fragment projected posteriorly. So that peche you will get abnormal prominence. So that can happen. Excessive backward tilt can happen at the time of fusion. Because of that, the hand will go into hyperextended elbow is what will basically result. And there is, whenever you want to flex, because of this excessive backward tilt at the time of fusion, that will limit the flexion from happening. So that is another important problem which can occur. So how do you treat that? I mean this malunion problem. You will basically cut that abnormally projecting part. That's called French osteotomy is what you need to do for supracondylar fractures which have malunited is what you need to remember. So this is how you do the correction where there is a development of valgus deformity and post French osteotomy which you can be able to do. Then myositis ossificans with the ectopic bone formation around the elbow joint that lead to development of stiffness is another important complication which can develop. And what is the reason for development of myositis ossificans? After a fracture, if you do excessive massage, then that lead to development of, predisposes to the development of myositis ossificans. So if it develops, what is the treatment? Give rest for about 3 weeks. After that, gentle elbow mobilization, not by doing vigorous massage. That is very important. And suppose if it is very severe, intense myositis, then ossificans, then you need to do excision of that myositic bone or excision arthroplasty is considered to be the management of choice. Then 2-3 comments on Volkmann's ischemic contracture. Already we discussed about it. Brachial artery injury is the one which is basically responsible. And what is meant by Volkmann's sign in order to diagnose Volkmann's ischemic contracture? Whenever there is any flexion of fingers, a simple ulnar nerve injury also can lead to claw hand deformity where flexion of fingers is there. Is it that or is it Volkmann's ischemic contracture? How can you be able to decide is a very, very important question. Very simple. These flexed fingers, the patient will be able to extend them if the wrist is made to flex. If the patient flexes his wrist, then these flexed fingers he can be able to extend. But if he extends the wrist, then these flexed fingers cannot be extended. That is the situation if it is the underlying causes. Volkmann's ischemic contracture. Simple, no? See, it is fibrous adductor. So, if the wrist is extended, wrist flexion, wrist extension. So, when wrist is flexed, then you are getting extra length available. So you can extend a flexed, because your fingers extensors, they come from the from your what you call forearm only, no? Whereas if at all the wrist is flexed, sorry, if the wrist is flexed, you can extend. But if the wrist is extended, the flexed fingers cannot be extended. That is the called Walkman's sign, is what you have to basically remember. Then this is a typical necrosis of the forearm muscles because of the Walkman's contracture. The gross appearance intraoperatively is what you are able to see. If it is only a mild deformity of Walkman's contracture, Walkman splint, earlier we have seen, no, that can be applied, Walkman splint. But if it is a moderate deformity, what will you do? It is all the flexor muscles which got fibrosed and contracted. All flexor muscles arise from medial epicondyle, anatomy. All extensors from the lateral epicondyle, no, common flexor origin. Right. So you release it from the medial epicondyle, the flexor muscle, common origin. That's called Max Page operation. That is what basically is done in order to relieve the Walkman's ischemic contracture. If it is very severe, then what you need to basically do? The forearm bones you need to shorten, right? So, or you need to do carpal bones excision. Ultimately, they got short. So, even the bone also you try to short. So that short bone, short muscle. So that there is nothing pulling done. So that is what is basically done. Carpentry job. So you must be ready to do that. So if you, that's the reason in housemanship, you have to decide where are your skills. Your skills are in reading, talking to the patient, choose general medicine. If your skills are into cutting, crafting and grafting, choose a surgical field. And suppose if you have a mismatch, if you have both of them, good. If you have both of them, what will you do? You cut onions in the morning for your, to help your spouse, and then become a general medicine guy and go to hospital. Because you have cutting skills, what will you do? They go wasted if you become physician, no? That's what my chief of medicine used to do. So on his retirement, his wife said, "Sir, there is a big tiger in the wards. Big lion, not tiger. Tiger is a bad animal. Lion, gracious animal. How is he in the home?" "Oh, in the home, he is a complete cat. He will wake up, give me coffee, cut all vegetables, everything, and then go to hospital. Then he will roar upon you." Yeah, so for that, he said that in reply, "That is the only pleasure that I had in the morning. Remaining part of the day is a big drama." So that's the reason, if you are a good in cutting, good in talking, you must be sure. Right, doctor? That's all the story of Suprakund. Let me see how much you understood. You need to give some confident answers. Yes. So the most common nerve injury, doctor, for a fat answer, karubide? Anterior interosseous nerve. Now you are very sure. Vaishali is reporting little video breaking. Please ask whether local internet problem. Para proposes median. After all our double emphasis, Nidhi correctly answers by saying anterior interosseous nerve. Very good. Now, all these are the complications of supracondylar fracture in children, except if you read, you will answer. So, non-union is not an issue. Mal-union is the issue, is what you have to basically remember. Come on. Most common type of fracture in a child is which one? Because we finished just now, supracondylar fracture topic. That's good. regarding supracondylar fracture of humerus, what is your answer? B. B. So it is not cubitus valgus, it is cubitus varus. That's good. Right? So last 2 weeks, Sundays, I was in Guntur with cardiology and neurology. I could not discuss the Sunday paper. So from this week, until the entrance is over, I will be discussing all Sunday papers. And from November 1st week onwards, we will have 2 full-scale grand tests every week. Wednesday and Sunday. Two full-scale grand tests. So, we'll finish more number of full-scale grand. Monday to Friday, except Wednesday, we will have the regular class in the evening. Okay? So, that's the plan. Right? It become a little difficult. Okay, okay. We'll try. We'll try. Otherwise, because Sunday, anyway, one first endocrinology session will be delivered on this thing. You have internet in the home? We'll give a broadcast. That's not an issue. Sunday, we'll try. Suppose if some more people come up, then we will try to organize the Sunday program. So Sunday, what happened is very few are there and few are also feeling very hungry for the lunch. Post lunch they are, you are having energy for. We'll see. We'll see accordingly how to finish at least general medicine. Orthopedics and general medicine we will try to do one session. Endocrinology will be taken full Sunday. We'll plan it accordingly. Now, supracondylar is over. This question is over. Then, 3-point relationship. What is your answer? Supracondylar fracture. Very good. Now, let's go to the next topic, doctor.